Hi, class. Today I'm talking more about writing on the web, and we're going to discuss blogging and web articles, a couple of the differences between them, and what you're looking for whenever you're writing for a blog, whether it's a personal one or professional. So first, what is a blog? Well, a blog is a combination of the words website and log. So it's usually something that's going to be frequently updated. Whenever we talk about a blog, they originally started as online diaries or sometimes as a type of a forum. It's really a semi-social media where you can connect with other people if you want, but you aren't necessarily obligated to include the ability to comment on things if you decide not to. A couple of the early blogs were from Justin Hall and Jorn Barger. Now, Justin Hall still has his website, links.net, up. It's more of a personal blog, but he has used it as in a professional manner at different times. If you want, definitely recommend taking a look. It's pretty interesting to see how even that kind of basic format still works today. Also, for Jorn Barger's blog, Robot Wisdom, it is no longer technically available online, but they do have it archived on the Wayback Time Machine. That's an internet archive area. I recommend going to look at it. You can see some of the posts and different things that he included on there. Now, blogs today are a combination of personal and professional information. It kind of depends on what your goal is, whether you're working for a company who's trying to connect with its audience, or if you are writing a travel blog because you're traveling to different areas, or maybe you want to write about your shopping experiences, like helping people to find deals in your area. All of those can be different types of blogs. Now, a business website versus a blog. A website normally includes product information. I'm sure you've seen some of those where they'll have a homepage and they'll say, hey, this is our latest and greatest, whatever. Or here are press releases related to an event we have coming up. Or maybe they'll include updates about a particular thing that's going on with them. Now, blogs are a little more social. Usually, they're available. If they're on a business website, it's going to be there more as a way to connect with the audience. And you're going to have more frequent and regular posts with a blog, usually updates about something, or it might be, this is how so and so says they use our particular product or something else like that. And a few other uses for blogs. You can use it to help you increase your search engine hits. When you have that regular sharing, you're regularly showing up and providing additional information, not just to your consumers, but of course, for all of the algorithms and different things. And it should help improve your search engines. Now, of course, it depends on what kind of search engine optimization you're using and other techniques that we'll go over at another point. But in general, it can help. It can also help you share information about a particular topic and be seen as an expert in your industry. And again, this is kind of one of those where you want to show your company's you know, collective face in public more often and to be associated with a product or a particular area. Kind of like when you think about when someone needs a facial tissue, they usually don't say facial tissue, they say Kleenex, because they've associated that product with that particular need. So you're trying to do the same thing by creating extra posts online and hopefully increasing traffic and user awareness. And we're also trying to attract visitors to a company website. And whenever you attract visitors, sometimes you're able to turn those into stories to help you improve maybe on your product, or if you're increasing visibility, then you might have more journalists show up, or just in general, get more traction online. And of course, part of that is cultivating an online community. And as we said, engaging with the audience through those user comments and through other platforms as well. Now, there are a lot of different blog sites. There are tons of places that will help you start up right away. If you want to host your own website, there are quite a few different website builders, some of which do offer free services if you don't want to pay the hosting fees and stuff like that. For example, on WordPress, they do have a free option, and so does Blogger. And you can also work on a website like Medium or Tumblr or LiveJournal, where they have a lot of individual and collective communities. DeviantArt is a bit more image focused, but I would argue is still something that you could consider a kind of image based blog. So now that we've seen different places you can host, explored a little bit about blogs, let's talk about the types of blogs and web articles that we'll see. The first is the personal essay. As I said, this is something that was kind of part of that pioneer group in the 90s, people writing their thoughts and experiences or their opinions about different things and posting them online. Some people did post with their actual information. Other people would use, you know, screen names and usernames to avoid anything being related to them in general, like in the public sphere. But usually this type of writing does still happen today. There are lots of people who do it. Of course, we also see that on Facebook whenever people are talking about about whatever's going on in their lives and stuff. That is very similar, especially when we see those longer forms. But we do also have different people and different and sometimes celebrity people posting on websites like Medium, where they will include their experiences working in a particular industry, or maybe providing a kind of editorial, so a personal view of a particular topic. And that's very similar to what we've seen in the traditional newspaper, whenever there's an opinion column or an editorial column. Now, the interview, many of you may be familiar with this from podcasts, or if you listen to traditional radio, this is normally where the host talks to a celebrity or a professional in the studio, and they discuss a how to do something, or maybe they're talking about a particular industry or a topic this person is involved with. Now, interviews can be really great. The only negative, of course, is often interviews are going to be a one-on-one affair. So you don't have that as much of an opportunity to include different opinions or different perspectives, unless you do a whole series where you're interviewing different people from different backgrounds in that particular industry. So interview topics, kind of like with other writing, you can focus on current or future events usually, or field-specific ideas, like if you're talking to someone who works in computer music and they're talking about new computer music software. Now, this might combine with another blog style. That's often a good idea if you're having issues with, if you're going through and you want to include those outside sources, or if you want to include additional information that may not be available with a purely interview format. Now, The Explainer is an online news article. It's often going to be closer to feature writing than to what we would think of as a blog. And this is often a guide related to a topic. And this could be like explaining what something is or why a particular thing happens the way it does. And the information within an explainer can be nonlinear. It can also be part of a bigger blog story or news story where you're expecting the audience to probably skip around and look at different information. That's what we're talking about when we say nonlinear, is that it doesn't have a specific way that you're expecting the person to read. It's part of why you're including subheadings whenever you write for a website, or whenever you're writing for a blog. You want it to be something that a person can glance over. Usually these are going to have more text than than another type of blog. Now, a how-to is a step-by-step guide. This is where you're bringing a person through start to finish on how to do something. You're still technically explaining it, but the way the how-to is set up, usually you want to have pictures or video going along with it. And you're explaining, okay, this is step A, this is step B, this is step C. You expect them to go in order through the process, and then they will end up with whatever product or thing you mentioned at the beginning of your article. Now, a list, or a listicle, as it's sometimes called, is a list article. We see these everywhere online. And these are often used whenever people are writing advertorials. That's where it's kind of an advertisement, but it's also providing information about different products or different places. And this is when you see a lot of year-end review lists or product reviews, the best or worst of something. And I included a link here if you want to view a little more about writing lists and how to make your list a little better and a little easier for your audience. Now, niche blogging is when you're focusing on one topic throughout the blog. So usually you're going to have kind of an overall theme for the blog site itself, and each post will focus on a particular topic. This is going to be something where you'll have probably more explainer type articles. And usually you're focusing on a particular group of people or maybe a thought process or a subject, a topic. For example, if we wanted to focus on women's rights or politics, maybe we're focusing on video games or new technology from, and it could be one of those with a particular perspective. It really depends. But in general, you're focusing on one subject throughout the blog, and then you'll focus on a specific aspect of that subject whenever you create a post. Now, one of the cool things about niche blogging when we're talking about a website is you're able to gather people with shared expertise. So you could have several contributors. You aren't limited to one person writing, although often these websites start with one or two writers and then they grow from there. And it's also something where it's possible to have more audience contributions. This is when you go on a website. For example, if you go to the Mary Sue, they have a little item on the bottom of their website where it says, if you want to contribute, this is our contact information. And they have an editor who goes through everything to see if it matches their website style and their different topics. So really cool. You can collect a lot of writers and put together a niche blog about a particular topic. So news blogging is more often associated with traditional news outlets. Now, when I say traditional news outlets, I'm talking about both broadcasting as well as newspaper groups, and also the newer online news groups. All of those people are more likely to include editorial content now because they're able to have these online blogs. And these articles are usually a bit more news oriented, and they might include some more traditional style articles within what would be generally considered a blog. But it's kind of a combination, and it's where that sort of swirl of personal information and professional information starts to happen with journalism. So it's pretty interesting to check out. You can look at a lot of different sites, like NPR has quite a few different things that would fall under news blogging category. One of them is called Goats and Soda, or just a few other things. And of course, other websites have it as well. Now, the question becomes, if these are traditional news outlets and they already have a medium, you know, they're writing newspapers or magazines, or they have if they already have their own airtime and stuff, why are they publishing online? Well, compared to those other media, it's less overhead. So there's a lot less, they have a lot fewer costs associated with publishing online versus publishing in a print newspaper. It still has advertising available, so they can still put in banner ads. They still have those, what I personally consider annoying, little extra Taboola things on the bottom where they're, it's like little advertising boxes and things, but it does help them to pay for that, as well as to increase their audience size, which in turn helps them to get more advertisers whenever they're looking to sell the more expensive airspace, like for radio and TV, or when they want to sell ad space in a newspaper. Another thing is news blogging provides a flexible schedule, and the medium itself is also more flexible. You can write 2 sentences about a car crash or about something that you saw circulating on Facebook, where you maybe spoke to a public information officer about it and they told you and explained that whatever it was wasn't really a big deal. And so you're able to publish that information in 2 or 3 sentences and be done, instead of having to write a whole story about it like you would if you wanted it in a newspaper or in broadcasting. And of course, the other thing is it does provide a 24-hour publishing schedule, so you can post whenever. However, of course, there are lots of algorithms and different things at work, so to help you determine the best times to publish. So even though you have the opportunity to publish at any time, they do have recommendations related to publishing schedules and what it is you're releasing. And another thing, when you publish online, you're able to expand content. This is an especially big deal when we're talking about broadcasting, where you have very limited airtime. They're able to add additional content to further improve their audience's understanding about a particular topic and create those more complex stories where we have that nonlinear narrative where you go between 4 or 5 different posts and all of them relate to each other. And it's also outside of the mainstream. So if you're looking to publish information you think a specific segment of your audience would enjoy hearing, then you're able to do that. And it, in general, provides more flexibility than broadcasting or traditional print news might. Now, with promotional blogging, this is where we start talking about combining marketing and advertising with writing published online. And this is often done to improve consumer relationships and increase brand familiarity. So, like we were talking about with publishing online, where you want to probably include more information about your brand, or you want to maybe get a little more information from your target audience and see what types of features and things they like, what they don't like. You can do it through promotional blogging. And this can also help your audience understand your company a little better. They can see kind of the day-to-day of running your company, or whenever you're developing a new product, maybe you want to send little preview videos with product information or a little more about the team working on it. Whatever it is, it's usually something that's going to be a little more outside of marketing emails when we're talking about promotional blogging within the kind of personal story sphere. Now, advertorials, that's where we might see like a news type article that talks about different products or services, or if we're talking about something that a particular group might find interesting. And there are a lot of different ways to include these without doing a blog, but blog posts can be very beneficial, especially when you include links where your audience can see exactly what you're talking about. And you're also able to not only show them how this product would work in their life, but you're also able sometimes to have a promotional event with someone who's considered an expert. Let's take a look at this Bon Appetit article where they talk about making a particular smoked salmon dish, but they also include links to different products they think would help whenever you're making it. Okay. So here's an example where we can see it's kind of an explainer how-to, but it also includes some advertising elements as well. And we're on the Bon Appetit website. And this is a recipe from April 2022, written by Sarah Gempel. And she is talking about making a Herbie Dutch baby with smoked salmon. So we can see from the picture, she's already showing us that it's something where we'll use cast iron. And we have that opening article. So kind of the lead section here where she's explaining, starting with what it is we're doing and what makes this dish so special, etc. And of course, like any good blogger would do, they explained that if you click on any of their stuff and you buy it, then they're going to get some feedback from it. Okay, now they show you a list of what you'll need in order to make this. And as someone who enjoys cooking at home, I can say that often they do go a bit overboard. And of course, you never really have to buy it from the location where they say. They're just showing you an example of stuff that they're offering. So they have the blender, cast iron, et cetera. And you can see they have everything in this very short little window here. And everything is available through a click link. Now, with this kind of how-to, since it is something where you need to know what ingredients, they have an ingredient list and then a step-by-step preparation. Some of these will include information and photos, like actually showing you what it is you're doing. But in this one, they didn't. But they did still break it down into like all of the different kitchen tools they say you'll need, ingredients, and the preparation and all the prep steps, including all the way to finishing the Dutch baby. And we can see they allowed comments on here. So you can go through the comments and see if it sounds like something you want to do, etc. And of course, we have lots of other recipes and things where they're providing basically the same type of stuff. Okay, let's talk about the online writing format. Now, here are some useful use of online writing. And of course, the first one is make sure your information is useful to your audience. Have urgent information. So that goes back to timeliness, making sure you're publishing something that works for now or the near future. You want it to be unique. Now, I would say this is unique with an asterisk because it's kind of like one of the kind of good and bad things about writing, especially when you start going online, is you get overwhelmed by the number of people who have already published specific types of information. And you say, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? There's already a million articles like this. Well, whenever you look at that information, see if maybe there's a different way for you to approach it and make yourself just a little bit different than everyone else. And of course, you want to be ultra specific. This is where that reviewing previous information part comes in. Now, if this information sounds familiar to you, it's because it is. This is very similar to the B's of writing. Whenever you want to, you know, you're still focusing on your content related to your goal at the end, which part of which should be focusing on what your audience needs, and also, of course, timeliness and providing a unique and specific set of information for your audience. Now, blog and web writing elements. We start with a headline, lead, body, and then your closing. Now, the headline. In general, you can probably apply the 80-20 rule of online writing, mostly because I know personally, whenever I look through websites, I'm reading, you know, probably hundreds of headlines a day and only reading a handful of the actual articles. So keep that in mind when you're developing your headline. You want to create something that is easy for your audience to understand and something that they can latch onto. So it's going to be a lot like what we practice with lead writing, except that you're writing this as your headline and then you will have a different information in your lead. So a headline for a web article or for a blog article can be longer than a traditional print headline. We're looking for carefully selected information, but you aren't limited to, you know, 4 or 5 words. You can expand on it and provide more specific information. This is the first part your audience interacts with when they look at your information. So if the headline doesn't get them, then they aren't going to see that really cool, you know, opening paragraph you wrote or any of the interview information or anything else. And when you write your headline, you want to start and end strong. This is where that noun-verb connection comes in. We're looking at action verbs. Create a sense of urgency for your audience and help them to understand why they should read this. And not only that, but you want to use familiar words. We aren't looking to, you know, to write something that sounds like it came out of Shakespeare. We just want something that your audience can understand and that they might think is useful. And here are a couple of examples. Like if you were writing for a newspaper, you might say start your spring garden this fall. But online, for an online heading, you're able to add a little more information. In this case, we have better spring gardens start in the fall, improve yours with these 5 tips. And you could still use a combination of the like newspaper and online information that I have here. If you wanted to have start your spring garden this fall, improve yours with these 5 tips. We're still focusing on, you know, providing that kind of number for someone to latch onto, as well as explaining more or less what the article discusses. Now, your lead, this is the opening of your article. It is very similar to the traditional news writing in that you still want it to be catchy. You still want it to include information. The difference is this is going to be kind of a slow burn throughout the article, where you aren't in a rush to provide all of your information at the very beginning. You want it to be kind of an opening for the larger amount of information you're giving them. So go back and review different online articles, and you'll see they have kind of that opening paragraph where they might provide a summary of the information, or it might be something that is more of an opening where they'll say like, hey, we're talking about this wonderful food dish like we saw in Bon Appetit, and we'll show you how to make it. So lead depends on your topic. Whatever it is, it does need to be different based on the type of article you're writing and also based on your headline. So this should not be a copy of your headline. Your headline is something different. So you have your headline and then you have your lead, and your lead will change a little bit if you're writing a more news type of web or blog article, or if you're promoting products or providing how-to information. The one thing I will say that carries over from the traditional news writing, of course, is avoiding the imagine lead. So instead, you want to use real information. So use real facts or quotes from experts or from other people related to the topic, and get your audience's attention that way with real information instead of telling them, imagine you're in whatever. You want them to instead hear information that's real. Now, the body of your paragraph, of your blog is going to be between 700 and 1600 words. The main reason I felt it was important to include a length in here is because it is important to understand what is considered too much or too little whenever you're writing online. Online writing has kind of the great and terrible thing of being both, of having a very, very flexible format. So when you're writing your body, you want to make sure you're matching the amount of information you're giving to your topic and to your audience. Whatever you're writing, make sure it's easy to read. So highlight main ideas using subheadings and provide a logical order to your information, even if it is something where you expect people to skip around. You still don't want to, you want to draw attention where attention needs to be drawn, not just randomly creating headings and subheadings. So consider your audience's needs when you're writing your body and you're going to use a combination of a subheading with paragraphs or subheading with bullet points. You can provide paragraphs with bullet points. It depends on what you're writing and how you need to provide that information. Now, you also have the ability to add media, that's photos, slideshows, videos, audio recordings, if you want to connect it to a podcast or to something else. PDFs of documents are especially helpful when you're writing for a website, especially when we're talking about longer form journalism. Including PDFs of the information, especially if it's a very complex case, will help your audience. And of course, you want to include links when necessary so your audience can see the original information. Now, your closing, you're going to have either a call to action or a way to wrap up your main ideas. This could be with a particularly meaningful quote. It could also be with a reference back to the introduction, a combination of those things. Whatever it is, you want to have a way for your audience to understand that this is finished, it's done. And if they want to see any additional information, if you're publishing a multi-part piece, then you might have a little information saying, hey, the next article is this. Or if you want to have a call to action, then explain what they can do with the information you've given them. Now, before you publish, of course, you want to check your work. Make sure all of your names, your dates, numbers, places, everything have been checked. Check your hyperlinks. Make sure that all of your website addresses are accurate and that if you're able to alter how they open, have them open in a new window. You don't want your audience to be drawn away from your website and never come back. So have additional information open in a new window if you can. The bigger thing, of course, is making sure that all of your URLs are correct, that they're going directly to the information you have available. If it's something where it might no longer exist online later on, then see if there's a way, and it's especially if it's important information related to your topic, see if there's a way to save it. Sometimes you can save websites as a PDF and have them linked within your document. Check all of your spelling and grammar. You don't want to be that person who writes an incorrect word that and later becomes a meme all over the internet. And you want to make sure that your grammar is correct. Remember, we want to build credibility with our audience. And check your additional elements. If you have photos, videos, PDFs, that they're contained within your website and you won't have to deal with broken content. That's when an element doesn't load on a page, either because the original host took it down or the URL changed or something else whenever you embedded it from another website. And whatever you include, if you have images or video from another source, credit them. Make sure your audience understands where you found these photos or these images. And of course, if you can, use alt text. This is especially important if you ever work on government websites. There is a certain amount of accessibility that they're required to have for people who are blind or for people who still have fairly slow internet connections and aren't able to, you know, load a video or load something else. And here are some references for you. I use these to when I was collecting additional information for this project. So go ahead, click through the links, see if there's anything interesting in there, and I will see you guys in class.